So here we have board 3, and Lila Koritze is white, Koltseva black. Koltseva is c3, playing with black pieces, and this is your area of expertise. Yes. This is the Catalan.
Exactly. Catalan, let's say, Stonewall type of position in the Catalan. Yes, e6. G3 is the move when if you want to reach a Catalan. Actually, this particular position cannot yet be named a Catalan. A Catalan means that black has played the move d5. After d5, this is a Catalan. For example, after c5, we may enter totally different territory.
English or Benoni.
Yes, this is Benoni with g3, for example. It's not definitely not a Catalan. Or... just a second. Or after knight f3, this is one type of English.
English opening, yes.
Yes. It's still not
a similar structure to the game we had before.
Exactly. Yes,
we
this
take
hedgehog
on d4 and there might arise a hedgehog type position. Bishop. But this is already a full-blooded Catalan.
So, bishop b4 check has been played. In my view, Catalan is a really great opening that one should probably study as a d4 player because he will learn a lot during the process. In my view, black has problems which line to choose. There are some lines where black wins a pawn, but they are very risky at the same time. White has a strong initiative. But there are some lines which are solid, but at the same time very passive. Just like the closed Catalan, which is very good if you are an experienced player, it is possible. But for amateur players, this setup with bishop e7 and castle short, this is very passive for black if he doesn't know exactly what he is doing.
Yes.
Most likely he will end up much worse. So in my view, the best line for black is bishop b4 check. The meaning of this move is that white will most likely have to play bishop d2. Actually, this is also possible. I have played it a few times myself. And even knight c3 is possible. But the most common move is bishop d2.
Definitely.
And now, this is objectively... The line chosen by black is, in my view, objectively the best line against the Catalan. But there is
it has a very good reputation.
Exactly,
it's very solid.
Being very solid. This is slightly less good objectively, but I would say much more active. Bishop e7 is very strong strategically, but a bit passive. Bishop d6 is, in my view, slightly less good, but more active. So if you are a good amateur player, I believe, or a good professional player, you should know both lines. If you have to choose one, choose bishop before check and bishop d6, this line with black, which is also comparatively new.
Yes.
So, in the game, bishop e7 has been played. What is the meaning behind this check? That this bishop is actually doesn't stand well on d2. White's idea is to play knight bd2 and go for e4. As every grandmaster would know. But here, white is forced to put a bishop on d2.
The ideal position for the bishop is on b2 in
on
this line.
Yes.
And actually, quite often, white does even play b3 and bishop c1.
Another idea is first to play e4, clarify the position in the center, and then decide about the bishop on d2. Let me give a small advantage, example. Bishop e7, knight f3, castle. Castle. This is called the open Catalan, and this is called the closed Catalan. This is a line that all amateur players should avoid to play with black because it is very passive. Knight bd2 or queen c2 first, they're more or less equally good. Of course, this is a solid and playable position, but you have to know very well what you are doing. In this position, I see very frequently moves like rook e8 or h6 or a6, which
are
all totally
meaningless. Yes.
White breaks in the center with e4, and now black is already much worse. In very high level chess, this game is already over. White will most likely win.
It's very comfortable for
yes. This bishop on c8 will find it very hard to be developed. It can go, for example, it can go to d7, but still it is very passive. And white has a wide range of options like bishop f4.
A move like bishop d7, I call it a formal developing move. It's like Black thinks, okay, I have this list of things to do, develop yes. my bishop. Aha, yes. I played bishop c8 to yes. d7, I develop my bishop.
You're
but,
absolutely
it's
right.
Absolutely, the bishop is not better placed on d7 than
exactly.
on c8.
Exactly.
It's ineffective.
Exactly. So black stays passive, and if he tries to play active, then this he will actually be even more exposed, because this monster on g2 is waiting to
exactly.
be activated.
These so are exactly the positions where black first closes the position, and then he feels he's under pressure, then he tries to open it, mm-hmm. and he's not prepared for it.
But so far it seems that black played normal position, normal moves, developing the pieces and castling, but still he ends up worse, which means if you still insist on playing this position as black, you have to know very specific theory. Anyway, in order for white to achieve all this, a knight should appear on d2. With this bishop before check, a bishop appears on d2. That's the positional
reasoning behind
exactly.
The check.
The check.
So Black's e7 is a good square for the bishop, but before mm-hmm. going there, we lure white's bishop to d2,
exactly.
where it's this, not so ideally placed.
This hit and run, yes, as we call
yep.
it. Okay. So,
not now.
Queen c2.
Not now.
Okay, queen c2, c6, and this is a theoretical position.
This is definitely a heavily theoretical position.
Mm-hmm. Bishop f4 is the move. Can white simply go here, somebody may ask, and knight bd2 and e4? Well, now he's a tempo down.
He's a tempo down. It costs him a tempo.
Yes.
Black's bishop is on e7, where it mm-hmm. should be, and white has lost time.
Exactly. So what is the downside of a move like bishop f4? If it is played very early, it may hit on some knight h5 ideas. That's the problem with the
yeah,
bishop.
Yeah, and that's exactly the moment where usually white plays bishop c1, and then Black's knight will not stay on h5 forever.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Quite often it returns to f6, and then white might consider playing b3, mm-hmm. bishop b2.
You know, very often I have suggested that there is another move here for white for amateur players, a very simple move that has one basic advantage. It is simple, it requires no theory, and most important, it keeps all the typical ideas of the Catalan. And this move is bishop g5. Objectively, uh-huh. this is not the best move, but it is very simple and practical to play. Next move is knight bd2 and e4. Whenever I see this, I take this knight, and I play knight bd2 and e4 next move. I don't have a huge advantage with white, but I have very simple play.
Well, you have the bishop on d2, it's just a source of trouble. And now mm-hmm. you have exchanged it, you have it
yes.
out of the way. You have given the opponent two bishops. This is a mm-hmm. slight concession, but mm-hmm. On the other hand, white has really easy play.
Easy play, and typical Catalan
I think
ideas.
H6 is not the ideal.
Not the idea. Maybe
the
B6 ideal. Is one way
yeah,
to go.
Yeah, just simply develop
yes.
B6, mm-hmm. bishop B7, I would
exactly.
say.
Exactly. Anyway, bishop F4. Is objectively better, but quite different than every other line of the Catalan. That's the problem. Knight e4. Black is playing for a stonewall type of position.
B3.
Yes.
Uh-huh, B3.
I think also knight c3 is possible, and I think also this move is quite typical.
Yes.
This move.
I suppose if white plays knight bd2, which seems like a logical developing move, then black would probably play something like g5.
g5, this is typical stuff. If white takes here intermediate mood, he's losing,
then he's losing,
he's losing
a piece. Which
exactly.
is not true after knight fd2.
Exactly. And after g5, this is only move. And now black can play what? Knight d6 or f5? I don't know. Even f5.
I think knight d6.
Knight d6, intending knight f5, yes?
Yes, yes.
Mm. Again, it is a playable position.
Yes. I don't know if this is exactly the same or only a very similar position, but Magnus Carlsen did beat Elianov with black
uh-huh,
in this
uh-huh.
line in
uh-huh.
Quite a pretty game.
Yes. So b3 has been played, f5,
knight c3. Okay. And now, obviously, the black player, the higher rated player, goes for the initiative.
Mm-hmm.
Bishop c1, okay. White understands that the bishop is not so well placed on d2, so she
or e3, it
or
is
e3,
exposed,
so
yes.
Bishop c1 is the best, yes. Definitely.
Yes. So
bishop f6. Bishop and now f6. She went bishop e3, mm-hmm. Which surprises me a bit.
I may be of a slightly different opinion. I believe it's an bishop a3 is an interesting move. I have played a very similar position with the black pieces many years ago in 1995, if I'm not mistaken, against mm-hmm. famous grandmaster from Australia, Ian Rogers. I had the black mm-hmm. pieces, and sometimes they follow this plan, which in my opinion queen e2 is not very effective.
Queen
but
a,
there is another
e8.
Very good plan, which is queen e7. Let's say white plays a normal move like e3 or something,
yes, okay.
And queen is coming to g7, taking control of of the central squares d4 and e5. It's very important, mm-hmm. in my view, to have the queen on g7, because it protects g5 pawn if necessary, and it is most importantly controlling e5 square. And now black is intending to simply develop with b6 and
bishop b7.
Once he does that, he has very good, once he achieves that, he has very good counterplay. For the moment, black is not playing for an attack. This might be a bit too much, but he has good control of the center, in my view. A better player might have
well, I don't
an
know,
even
but,
better opinion.
Bishop on e3 looks sort of unnatural. I mean,
this
is what
you mean. Yes.
Ah, no, but she played bishop a3. I'm sorry.
Yes, bishop a3.
I thought she played bishop e3.
No, I'm
it's my mistake. Okay, bishop a3 is much more logical, naturally.
Mm-hmm. Here, rook a7.
Rook d1. She develops the rook, and now she can choose where mm-hmm. the bishop can remain on a3 or can return to c1 even. Mm-hmm. Like you said, the rook is already developed. It hasn't stayed on d1, and the bishop can, let's say, return to c1 if it's necessary.
And now white played bishop b2 again back, right?
Yeah.
And black continued with h5, and white took here, which in my opinion is a very good move,
uh-huh.
Intending to play obviously
knight
to e5 next move.
Yes.
Yes. Let's say black takes with the f pawn. Most likely white will go
knight
here.
E5, yes.
And black is underdeveloped. White wants probably to open the center with some f3 at a good
once,
moment.
Once the position opens up, rook a8, bishop c8, not playing.
Yes, not playing, and it's, things are going to develop very fast, and white will have an advantage. For example, if black goes here, shall we give an advantage? Here,
yes.
Even blundering a pawn, yes?
Yes, now we
bishop
can take on
here.
e4, bishop
yes,
takes
this is
e4,
losing
just,
a pawn for
just
nothing.
Nets of pawn for white.
Yes. Should black take here again? He is much worse because the dark squares are very weak.
Definitely, although the long diagonal a1 h8 isn't open, but the bishop can end up somewhere
yes.
on d6.
Yes,
white
yes,
is going
yes.
to open the f file. It's mm-hmm. not black who is attacking here.
Mm-hmm.
Black's attacking moves, g5, h5, now only weaken his position.
The king, exactly. While, you see, as I mentioned, with a queen rather than a rook on g7, this knight e5 jump wouldn't be possible if black had a
queen on
g7.
Well, of course, e5 is one of the crucial squares in the
mm-hmm.
Stonewall.
Mm-hmm.
But we already have black taking
with
the d-pawn, which
okay.
In my opinion is probably a better choice.
Okay, I suppose white will still
I suppose anyway, knight. Yes, definitely, that's the way to go.
Mm-hmm. Knight e5. And
still white wants to push f3
mm-hmm.
and open the position.
Yes, if black tries something like this, then she is strategically lost already. For example, here a move like this should
exactly.
be
exactly. I mean,
yes.
this is contrary to the position we looked at earlier
mm-hmm.
with f takes e4.
Mm-hmm.
Now the d file is open, and
some
white even has an outpost on the open file. This
exactly.
is a huge advantage for
yes.
white.
Somebody may ask, but can't black attack with h4? This an experienced player immediately understands that. No, there is actually no real attack. To the amateur's eye, sometimes a move like this may look very active for black. Anyway, white is never intending to take on h4. This is simply a winning position for white because black's queenside is completely undeveloped.
Well, to have a successful attack, to conduct a successful attack, you need more than just one piece.
Exactly.
I mean, advancing all your pawns and having no pieces in place, it's just looking for trouble, because once the position opens up, your own king will end up weakened, and this is going to be the case here. I mean, no rook, rook on a8, bishop on c8 are not playing.
Of course, what we're saying here, what we're indicating are quite easy for a grandmaster or for a very experienced player to understand, but to the amateur side, things do not look so simple. So, we are here.
White is still thinking, but knight e5 is a very natural move. I somehow suppose hardly black will play, white will play something else.
How about this move, threatening to win a pawn, and black wishes that white will take on d7, and she will develop very fast with bishop takes.
Yes, but actually I don't think it's such a big threat to take on e5.
Already, you mean, yes?
So maybe I would consider playing something like f3 anyway.
f3, this is very principal move. What is, many times we hear principal move, what is the definition of principal move? It is ignoring your opponent's threats and carrying on with your own ideas.
Yes.
I play f3, ignoring, calculating them, estimating them, and then choose to ignore them. We saw that e5 is under attack, and still we play f3. This is a principal move, not necessarily correct, but in the correct direction, let's say. It has to be accurately calculated.
Of course, I mean, it will be connected with a pawn sacrifice, because after e takes f3, I don't really want to take with a knight, for example.
You want to take with e pawn?
I think with a pawn, yes.
Yes.
Probably.
And most likely, if black decides to win a pawn, he will lose. Yes, take and check.
I take and check on d8. This has been caused by black's rook leaving the basic rank. Now white has huge compensation.
Huge compensation. I agree.
Still there are two black pieces which are not taking part in the fight.
Exactly.
So even if I play something like rook fd1, maybe f4 is stronger. I don't know. But even here, how is black going to continue?
Yes. Even this endgame is very good for white, because one argument says, I am a pawn up, I go to the endgame, but another argument says, yes, but you exchange your only active piece with black, and now all
true.
The remaining pieces are very passive. Yes, even here, white is running, of course, absolutely no risk of losing. If he concentrates on regaining his pawn, he will definitely win a pawn back, but this is not his goal at all. He's playing...
I think King H1 is probably even stronger than Queen F2.
Ah, you think so? Yes.
Yeah. Why
yes,
not?
Yes. I agree. Okay. So the general feeling is that unless we are missing something, and if White finds this very strong move,
Queen F3, C7 has already been played. Uh-huh. Yes. Yes.
And in our
F3 looks promising for White. Definitely.
How about such a move? Now we are going to have a complicated battle, but with white being better developed.
Yeah, okay, now I can already really consider taking
take on
d7, let's
yes.
say, and on e4. Then.
And then on e4, and... yes, let's continue for a while. I take e takes f5 looks strong.
Takes f5 looks pretty strong, I would say, yes.
Yes.
Well, I can take simply the pawn on d4.
On d4, yes. Over here, you mean, or first we take?
No, first I would take on f5, yes. First taking on f5.
E takes f5, or even e5, but e5 is a pawn.
Okay, e5 down. Is a pawn down. I'm not too bothered with e5.
Yes.
If you pin my rook after exchanging on d4, queen c5, I always have e3.
Yes, e3. There are other possibilities like give check, sacrifice on f5 maybe should be considered.
This looks excellent as well. Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, basically, black is just coming out with his pieces, and white is much better coordinated, so this looks like a big advantage.
Exactly.
For white. So F3 is a logical move.
Yes, logical and very strong for an experienced player. a principal move, as we said. Should we think over f? Should the player think 40 minutes over f3? The answer is no. You cannot calculate. You simply cannot calculate every possible variation.
Exactly.
You will lose on time. I mean, you will get a good position, but lose on time. You have to rely on also on your intuition. The first thing is calculation, but immediately after that is intuition, experience, and also
feeling for the position.
Feeling for the position, following the chess principles. You know, opening the position with a better development, finding the best principle that applies in the position and use it. So we open the position while black
actually when I wrote a book about Kasparov, he's annotated about 130 of his games, which I chose myself, which I considered his somehow best or brilliant games. And in his games, I saw it really quite often that he tended to sacrifice material for the initiative.
This is very well
known. This was typical for him. And somehow he managed to get positions in which the material advantage was meaningless. And that it seemed even that he had a material advantage because he had the advantage, he had the pieces where he needed them. Uh-huh. And there he had more pieces, more power. Uh-huh. He sacrificed the piece, but it seemed like he has an extra piece because he had all his pieces trained on black skin,
I see. Okay.
And he was playing sort of power play.
This is the case here. White opens the position with f3, and although the material is equal or he's even a pawn down, it seems that he has more forces.
Yes.
Because the play is directed where white is better developed.
Okay, let's move on to another game. Sure, I mean, she's thinking about f3. Position at this point, and in the game it turned out differently. White somehow lost thread of the position. Instead of f3, which we proposed, she played queen d2.
But this helps black to develop the pieces very fast. This is the problem.
Yes.
That's why we would play
now
f3.
Suddenly, all the lines we analyzed 1.5 hours ago were mainly based on the fact that black's rook on a8 was completely out of play.
Mm-hmm.
And now suddenly, okay, f3, the move we suggested. And now, well, I would take with a pawn at
with
least.
The pawn,
but
yes.
She took with the rook, rook f8. All black's pieces are playing and the outcome is completely open.
Yes.
I don't know if white has an advantage here anymore. Mm-hmm. Well, probably yes. Probably it's still quite good for white.
Mm-hmm. The mistake came later, yes.
But she sort of underestimated that black has counter chances. Black
and
has play on the king side.
Yes, counter chances, and now a very safe king for black.
Yes,
at this moment, no counter. No,
well, this is all major pieces are connected with black's king. The rooks protect the king, and the pawns are advancing. The pawns are threatening.
Mm-hmm.
Black wants to play to take on g3 and then play
f3.
Either f3 or h3, create a passed pawn.
How about such a move? I don't know. How about such a move?
To
put the bishop on d6. But I think even this is not such a big deal. I mean, even...
Yeah, okay, the bishop on d6. Yeah, the position is still not so clear, but the tide has sort of turned. White is... black has already got his counterplay, at least.
Course. And maybe even a psychological advantage as well,
yes.
Because both players knew that somehow white was better at the beginning, but she lost the threat.
Yeah, well, what happened now, I see she was afraid of getting her bishop locked in, so that's why she played bishop e3, and after f3, she decided to play your idea. Queen e3, now rook g7, and gh4, queen h4. Queen d8 with the idea of taking. Well, it's still Not 100. Oh, this is not clear at all.
Not clear at all. I agree.
Because I don't have access to the h7 square.
Uh-huh. Both kings are weak.
Queen f7.
Is some d5 idea possible? I mean, even
this happened right now. She played
right
d5.
Now. But I have the feeling, without getting very deep in the position, I had the feeling that maybe
d5
this
immediately
might be
more dangerous.
More dangerous. Yes, I want to be able to
isn't use. Isn't your pawn on e5 attacked?
Just
as
simple
take,
as that. Yes.
Ed5 and queen e5.
Just as simple as that. Yes, and take here. Yes.
Yeah, h7 right. Is protected. This looks okay for black.
Yes, yes. I agree.
So king h1. She played d5 now when the pawn is not attacked anymore. But this ran into okay takes and queen f4. So
everything
now white has to swap queens. Yes. Well, now it's getting.
This
dangerous.
Pawn on f3 is very
pawn on f3 is very dangerous.
Yes.
And rook d4 self-pinning the rook.
Yes, threatening bishop h7, but of course.
Yeah, but black plays king f8. Yes.
F8.
And now black in turn is threatening to take on d5. I see what happened. This is move 39. I mean, it must have been big time trouble, I guess.
Can this move be played? I know it's risky, obviously.
Okay,
I see
so
bishop c6.
Bishop c6
stuff.
Is the obvious obvious response.
I think this might be good enough.
But this looks really good for black.
Yes.
Bishop takes c6, rook takes d4.
Yes,
I mean,
yes,
okay.
Nothing.
Check, king e7. So, and the final was sad for white because she played rook c4. And after b5, the rook has to go back, has to go to an unprotected square, either b4 or d4, and now she resigned because, well, white is losing a piece, and the position is just
after
falls apart.
After black developed her pieces, she played really strong moves, I believe.
Yes.
Very good game. Very accurate.
Yes, she played straightforward and well. I mean, she realized that she must play actively, otherwise she has no real chance. This game that we watched till knight g5, I think,